Okay, I'm gonna turn things over to Linda Manzi, take the requisite legal steps to formally open our meetings.
Good morning, I note that Todd Sherman, representing Mr. Robert Majorica, Director of the Division of Budget, is participating in the meeting via video conference from the New York State Division of Budget Conference Center at the Capitol Building 131 in Albany, and Andrew Sanfilippo from the Agncy's Buffalo Regional Office at Electric Tower, 535 Washington Street, Street 105. I will ask for motions and seconds to call into order the April 13th, 2017 Audit Committee meetings for the New York State Housing Finance Agency, the New York State Affordable Housing Corporation, the New York State Mortgage Agency, the New York State Municipal Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation. May I have motions for the HFA and AHC?
So moved.
Second.
And second, thank you. Motions for Sunny May?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Second.
Motion for MBBA and TSFC?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
As items are presented to the committee throughout today's meetings, these motions and seconds will be used unless specific items call for a different vote, or unless any committee direct member or director wishes to record his or her vote differently. Please note that Chairman Thompson is the agency's chairman and will chair the audit committees for MBBA and TSFC. Ms. Miller is the audit committee chair for Sunny May. Mr. Davidson is the audit committee chair for HFA and AHC audit committees and will chair the committee meetings for HFA and AHC. For purpose and convenience, and to make sure the meetings are of the respective agencies go smoothly, items shared by one or more agencies will be presented by Mr. Davidson.
A lot of pressure to make sure it goes smoothly.
You can do it.
I was trying to note who that was in Buffalo.
Mark Schroeder.
Oh, is that Mark? I'm sorry, my glasses aren't working. So we will correct the record.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Controller.
We still have.
Good morning.
So we're good to go.
Okay, great. Item number one. The following minutes shall be deemed approved, absent corrections from members and directors. Adoption of the minutes. Do I need to read them, or can we just? Adopt the ones. Okay, 63rd HFA Audit Committee Members Meeting, 58th AHC Audit Committee Members Meeting, Sunny May Audit Committee Directors Meeting, 50th MBBA Audit Committee Directors Meeting, and the 49th TSFC Audit Committee Members Meeting. We will now move to action items. Item two, approval of the internal audits work plan for fiscal year 2018. Steve?
Behind tab two, you have your internal audit work plan for fiscal year 2018. As in the past, I've used the same format. There's four schedules. One is a calendar of events. The other one is a budget in hours. Also, our audit objectives, and lastly, a summary report, which gives us the amount of hours for testing, for analytical review, internal control review, and administration. But before I go into this year's plan, I'd just like to briefly discuss last year's plan. Last year's plan was approved on April 14th, 2016. We completed 11 internal audits, and we assisted the New York State Financial Services Group in their examination of Sunny May. However, we didn't complete this plan as scheduled, and we're going to carry over a limited number of hours for the procurement audit into this year's audit plan. And the reason for that was not for the lack of effort. I attribute the cause to not having the anticipated number of man hours in developing the plan. This year's plan is as aggressive as last year's plan. We're going to develop for staff of four and myself. We plan to do 11 audits again, four fully integrated audits, four Sunny May audits, HFA, AHC, and a tobacco audit. The plan was developed after a review of internal controls, vulnerability and risk assessment, and also discussions with management. So we're going to ask you to approve this year's audit plan for fiscal year 2018.
Questions?
Two quick questions. I note that on the schedule you have two servicer audits. What is the schedule? I mean, is there a period of time over which you get to all servicers, or do you select certain?
There's actually three servicer audits.
Must have missed one, sorry.
Yeah, there's, what happens is we have to cover the top six servicers within a three-year period, and within that time, because the top six servicers are about almost 90% of the mortgage loans. So within 3 years, we have to cover the top six. So we generally do two of the top six each year, 3 years in a row, and then we substitute a more or a smaller one, just to make sure that they're aware that we exist and that we're checking up.
And then on the IT audit, I know we look at information security. Does that cover privacy questions?
It does, okay. And it's a high-risk area, so we have to perform that within 9 months of 1 year period.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I go.
You go.
Okay. So now before all five committees is a resolution of the Audit Committee of the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, New York State Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Municipal Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Finance Corporation reviewing and approving internal audit plan for fiscal year 2018. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the resolution adopted.
Item three, approval of internal audits, follow-up audit, 2015 audit reports.
This is a different type of audit than we normally perform. Here we go back to the audit reports issued in 2015 to see if management has implemented the recommendations as well as corrected the exceptions and agreed upon. We performed 11 internal audits also that year, and we've listed the titles in the body of the report for your convenience. The result of the testing was that we were able to determine that 11 of the 16 recommendations have been implemented and were corrected, the exceptions, which is about 69%. Of the five that remain outstanding, however, one was recently implemented. We couldn't obtain a decent sample size, so we're going to follow up on that in the future. But the other four are listed in the report, and their status has been brought current to date. So we're going to ask you to approve the plan, approve the report and management's response.
I guess the only question I have is, it seems like for some of these items, they've been reported back repeatedly with new deadlines. And I wonder whether you have any sense of whether the new deadlines are going to be held to.
We've discussed this, and, because it is from a prior year's audit report. And, appears that the tasks apparently were more difficult than they anticipated, pushing the target dates further out. One, of course, has to do with publishing a manual for human resources and doing evaluations. So we accept their judgment, and we'll follow up on it.
Now before all five committees is a resolution of the Audit Committee of the State of New York Mortgage Agency State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, the State of New York Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Municipal Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation reviewing and approving the internal audit account payable audit report. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the resolutions adopted.
Excuse me. I think you approved the report that's coming up.
Right. We need to do the follow-up. And then we'll do the accounts payable next.
I apologize. That's my error. A resolution now before all five committees is a resolution of the Audit Committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, the State of New York Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Municipal Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation reviewing and approving the internal audit follow-up audit of the 2015 audit reports. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye. The motions are carried and the resolution adopted.
Item four, approval of internal audits, accounts payable audit.
So here we reviewed the accounting records and system internal controls for accounts payable as of August 31st of 2016. The accounts payable group is responsible for the funding of payments for vendor contracts that the agency enters into, payment for things like office supplies, processing payroll, and any other bills that come through the agency. On average, they process approximately 6,000 transactions a year at about $42 million. All transactions are processed through the expenditure control system. They're also responsible for processing accounting transactions, as well as preparing the financial statement for the accounts payable group. I won't go into the details of the report. It's in, of the operation. It's in the body of the report. Our audit did include a review of purchases, both contractual and non-contractual, a reconciliation of disbursement accounts, credit card transactions, employee travel expenses, accounting transactions, and of course, internal controls. The result of the audit was we were able to satisfactorily achieve our audit objectives. However, we felt that management could strengthen internal controls by documenting the corporate purchase card policies and procedures, as well as to revise the corporate travel card procedures by including expenditure documentation, as well as the time frame for pre-approval. There are four items in the report, and management has responded to them, and we're going to ask you to approve this report response as well.
So in a bit of deja vu, now before all five committees is the resolution of the audit committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, the State of New York Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Mortgage Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation, reviewing and approving internal audits, accounts payable audit report. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the resolution adopted.
Approval of internal audits, servicer audit of JP Morgan Chase Bank.
Here we reviewed the mortgage records and the systems of internal control for the single family mortgages that are serviced by JP Morgan Chase Mortgage Group. As of our audit, they were servicing approximately $139 million in loans. J.P. Morgan Chase Mortgage is a subsidiary of J.P. Morgan Chase & Company, who had about $2.4 trillion in assets on their balance sheet as of 12/31/15. They are a full-service mortgage group. They deal with originations, acquisitions, servicing of residential and commercial properties. Payments can be made at their branches or to lockbox operations. Deposits are FDIC insured. The results of our audit was we were able to generally satisfy our audit objectives. However, we feel that management can strengthen internal controls by monitoring the processing of foreclosed loans and the process of foreclosures, as well as the termination of primary mortgage insurance. There were two items in the report, and management has responded to them, and we're going to ask you to approve the service.
Now before the Senate EMA Committee is a resolution of the Audit Committee of the State of New York Mortgage Agency reviewing and approving the service for audit of JP Morgan Chase. Assuming the first and second previously entered for the Senate EMA Committee, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motion is carried and the resolution is adopted. Now the next item on page four.
Resolution. The next item on the agenda is a consent item. There will be no discussion on the following item unless board members, directors so desire. Item six, resolution recommending approval of the 11th annual evaluation by the audit committee.
So now before all five committees is a resolution of the audit committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, the State of New York Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Municipal Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation concerning self-evaluations. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the resolution is adopted.
The next two items on the agenda are information items. There will be no discussion on these items unless committee members, director, or directors so desire. Item seven, internal audits mission statement. Item eight, financial statement update for the first quarter of fiscal 2017, third quarter fiscal 2017 for AHC. The last item on the agenda is part of our audit committee education program, and there will be a presentation for the committees. Audit, item nine, Audit Committee Education and Training, discussion of accounting policy and other accounting issues.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
So Daryl and I are coming up to discuss start the education session focusing on accounting policies. During last year's examination of Sunny May by the New York State Department of Financial Services, a report that had previously been approved by the board, it was recommended that a survey be conducted amongst board committee members concerning completeness and accuracy of policies and procedures, and this survey be rated on a point scale representing their approval. Now, the annual survey, which just came through as a consent item, does mention accounting policy. But in order to satisfy this request by the examiners, and also just because it's important to go through accounting policy, we're going to focus on that today. You should have a PowerPoint that was distributed going through.
As a bold.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to begin with a general overview of accounting policy and discussion of the policy governing post-employment benefits, which is OPEB, and other pension expense and certain MIF accounting policies. This presentation is not intended to be complete since there are many accounting policies. We will follow further presentation on policy on a regular basis, and also Ernst & Young is always coming to talking about accounting policy. In fact, their September meeting where they give the audit plan, they go through any impact of new pronouncements made by the governing boards and the effect that will have on our policy. The most important policies are found in the notes of the agency's financial statements, and I'm going to go through some of these now. The financials are accounted for in accordance with accounting principles generally accepted in the United States, or GAAP. As government entities, we follow GAAP as prescribed by the Government Accounting Standards Board, or GASB. All of the pronouncements, we usually say GASB number, and that's how they're referenced. This differs from private industry, which follow GAAP also, of course, but they are prescribed by the Financial Accounting Standards Board. In the absence of any statement from GASB, we go back to FASB as well. The most important policy is the basis of accounting, and this is at the beginning of note two. All the agencies are accounted for in the accrual method, wherein revenues are recognized when earned and expenses when incurred. This basically means that it's not required to have a cash transaction completed in order to account for a transaction. That would be the cash method. Instead, transactions are accounted for as they occur, not when they are settled with cash. And that's, of course, common for any large entity. Under the accrual method, interest and investment revenues are recognized throughout the time the particular investments are held, when earned, and not when the investment matures or interest is received. So on the investment, you calculate the accrued interest up to the time that you're reporting, and that's reported as earnings. Interest earnings and investments are recognized the same way. Fees charged and other revenues are recognized when earned and not when the cash is received. For example, interest due on a loan for the first month for October is recognized as income in the month of October, even though it's not due till November 1st. Another policy concerns evaluations of investments held. Our investments were recorded at their fair market value. We determine the fair market value by pricing the investments held on the dates of the financial statements. The market price is then compared to book value, and an adjustment, either increasing or decreasing the investment value on the financials, is recorded. On the statement of revenues, expenses, and change in net position, which is the income statement, but in government that's what you call it, the net change in fair value is shown separately from investment earnings. This represents a difference between the cost and the market value on the date of the financials, but it also affects the reversal of the amount made in the prior period. Basically, it's like an adjustment entry. It goes up and down. And that one's actually kind of hard to explain. We always struggle in the MD&A to even come up with words to describe how you're reversing out last year's adjustment, putting it back on this year's adjustment. It's really the difference. On the state of net assets, the value you see from the investments is the fair market value. You never see the difference between book and market here. It's blended in to the value. Another policy is bond issuance expenses, which are incurred as expense as spent. This was, a couple of years ago, there was actually a GASB that changed this, and we had to change our policy. They had required that you recognize the cost of issuance expense of issuing debt over the life of the related debt, which in a way makes sense because the debt lasts a while, so you're going to have those costs of issuance for a while. But in another way, you're never really going to recover that. You spent it already. So this actually makes it a lot easier and I think a lot cleaner. So a couple of years ago, I thought GASB, I was very happy with this GASB, when they said recognize them as you incur them. Now here's where, there are a couple of things. I'm going to talk about the OPEB expense because it always comes up and I have a feeling we just kind of mention it at these meetings and never go through it. Now OPEB, which, I didn't note the charts where we talk about the post-employment retirement expense on the fourth page, the blue line to the $2,553,000. I'm focusing on Sunny May today because the examiners only examined Sunny May and not to go through too much. This is similar for all the entities. This is only recognized by HFA and Sunny May, the OPEB expense, because we have because of the way the payrolls are. We have three payrolls, AHC, HFA, and Sunny May, but the AHC and the HFA report together on the OPEB expense. So the OPEB expense, which is other post-employment benefits, now that relates to the cost of providing for, that means benefits when they say other, that means other than pension. So the OPEB expense relates to the cost, primarily to the cost of providing for a payment of the portion of health insurance for eligible retirees. Instead of recognizing these costs, they are paid out after retirement, an actuary analyzes the data to determine the cost of the benefit it has earned. In other words, the expense is recognized as determined by the actuary for all employees as they are employed, not as the funds are paid out. So they figure out like what's the likelihood that this is going to be paid out, and they have a discount method rate, they figure out what the costs of Medicare are, all that comes in. It's a big calculation, which I actually brought up with me. I'm not going to walk through the whole thing, but this is provided by our actuaries to show us the OPEB costs. It's done biannually. You only have to do it every other year. And Ernst & Young reviews this. They actually, last year, they had a big blowout discussion between these actuaries, which I couldn't believe, determining about what mortality table they should be using. So you have the Ernst & Young actuaries actually reviewing the actuary that we work with.
The actuaries that we work with are external, correct?
External, Milman. And we've been working them a number of years. So the accounting treatment, it was promulgated by GASB 45. So a lot of times we call it the GASB 45 expense also. And I put the table in here comparing the 2 years. That actually shows that the net OPEB obligation for Sunny May on page 5 was $49 million. We don't have we don't fund the GASB 45 expense by putting in a separate trust, which you can do, but we don't do that. And this kind of goes through the way that it's calculated. They take the amount that they would have had to contribute. They actually add in the interest that would be earned using the discount rate on the prior year's balance. Then they amortize the amount over 10 years to come up with an annual cost, take out the payments made, and then you have the increase, which shows your expense. So that's actually going to be changed in a couple of years. They're actually changed the method. I just heard from the actuary about what effect he thinks this will have on us, about when the discount method is determined. They're going to have to do the calculation annually, but more on that when they actually do it. He says it'll actually make it a little bit clearer the way they're going to be doing it next. Now, so the accumulated liability, as you can see on that table for Sunny May, was $49.145 million. Now, the next one that I'm going to go through a bit has just changed recently, which is the pension expenses. Now, we used to record the pension expenses, as was allowable by GASB, as we paid our payment out to the New York State pension. Now again, we're just paying the pension for the employees that are covered by the pension. We don't determine the amount of the pension liability. The state has a gigantic liability for pension, which is actually very well funded, you'll always hear. And that's why our liability really isn't that high. So the pension expense used to be based on the payments, but now we actually have to go through the state's actuarial tables. Now, this is a portion of one of them, it's 180 pages long. Then they give us some charts, which actually refer back and point us to exactly what we should be recording. But we're just relying on the state controller's actuary because we're participating in the system. So they consider the amount that each entity is responsible for a portion of the expense. And HFA and Sunny Mae are small compared. Yes?
The state controller's actuary is an employee of the state controller, is it not? Or is it an outside independent control?
I don't know.
It's probably an outside individual.
In New Jersey, it's actually part of the state controller, the state treasurer's office.
Yeah, the only thing about it is because of the calculation then of what you'd have to pay, and that would create a little bit of a conflict. I'm not sure if it's, it usually is slightly, the actuary is usually slightly separate. We can check it.
Yeah, I don't need to have the answer immediately, but I would like to have it.
Okay. We'll check on that. It might even say it in the report, but so I'll go through this thing and see if we can find it. The pension expense for Sunny Mae for fiscal 2016 was $1.9 million, and the net pension liability was $3.9 million. And they have a lot of deferred items going through, which Daryl's going to go through more of the definition of what deferred items are when he does his presentation. Any other questions on these two? Okay. Another important policy, I figured if we're going to be talking about Sunny Mae, I should mention something about the MIF. As Michael was just talking about before, the amount of the excess balance that's paid based on the recording taxes, which he also mentioned. I don't know if that's really something that the PowerPoint would have in there, but as you're aware, MIF collects a portion of recording taxes from counties in the state to fund the various accounts held by the MIF. And on an annual basis, the MIF takes the amount collected over the past year, adds the interest income, deducts expenses, and the insurance reserves to arrive at the excess balance. And that amount is certified in May and remitted to the state in accordance with whatever state directive we get. The calculations actually start in March when we certify the expenses, and it progresses through until we finish up in May. So when the MIF receives its share of the recording tax, the MIF tax surcharge revenue is recorded and recognized, increasing the insurance reserves when the funds are remitted to the state and expenses charged. And then we have on our financial statements is an amount restricted for insurance requirements. That was $1.8 billion at the end of the year. So if you look at the page 3, going back a bit, you can see that when we present our net position, we break it out by the amount that's reserved for bond obligations, and then there's the amount for insurance requirements, which is shown separately because you don't want to mix the bonds with the insurance, it's not the same. And then the coming to the unrestricted deficit, which is actually in the general operating fund. And the amount of the deficit is because of the GASB 45. It's because of the GASB 45 liability, which is shown against the general operating fund. And you're not going to take money out since the program's not funded. You don't take the money out until you actually spend the money, even though we've set it aside now. So this results in a deficit, which is again like a paper deficit in a way, because you have the money in the bond funds and the insurance funds as you need them, but we have to record the liability now. You're not going to take it out of those accounts where it's needed until you need it here. Any questions on this? No? Daryl, second. Thanks.
Hey, good morning. I'm going to walk through a few of the accounting policies, but before I do that, you could turn to page 7. I brought in a slide that I presented at the January meeting. I believe it was Nestor had a question on net position and changes in net position. And I was a little vague. I wanted to just add a little clarity and example for context. So if you turn to page 9, okay, here we have the Sunny Mae condensed statement of net position on the left, and on the right, the summary revenue expenses and changes in net position on the right. The left, the net position is basically your balance sheet, private sector company, and the summary of revenues, expenses, and change in net position is your income statement. Okay, your assets are your resources or things you own, your liabilities are what you owe, your deferred outflow of resources. That represents a consumption of net assets that relates to a future reporting period. I'll go more into that in a few minutes. And your deferred inflow of resources is an acquisition of net assets that relate to a future reporting period. Net position on the balance sheet side is just a residual of all the elements presented. So it's your assets plus your deferred outflows, less your liabilities and deferred inflows, that equals your net position, and that's what's circled on the left. On the following page, that would be slide number 10, I have Sunny Mae statement of revenue expenses and change in net position. I've circled the increase and decrease in net position. Okay, it's basically your operating revenues less your operating expenses, net of your non-operating revenues and expenses. That equals your increase or decrease in net position. Turning to page 11, I just show how the two financial statements are related. The change in net position is indicated as the net position for the current fiscal year, 2016, less the net position for the prior fiscal year. So you see the 63,906 is the difference between 2016 and 2015's net position. Any questions on that so far? I'm going to come back to the deferred items. Okay. Hope that clarifies it a little, Nestor. Okay, sure. Okay. Virtually all of our accounting policies are based on GAAP, as Gary mentioned, generally accepted accounting principles. GAAP is the body of accounting rules and standards which determine how transactions are accounted for and reported. GAAP for government entities is generally promulgated by the GASB, the General Accounting Standards Board, and to a lesser extent by the FASB, and in some instances by industry practice. So we'll walk through a couple of different transactions and explain the accounting policy and the reporting requirements. The first one I'm going to talk about is GASB 51, which is on page 12. I have an excerpt from there. It talks about intangible assets and how and when they should be capitalized. Examples of intangible assets include easements, water rights, timber rights, patents, trademarks, computer software, and internally generated computer software. For us, it's going to be the computer software because that's what we have that we're going to be capitalizing. Okay. So just to kind of give you an example, in a private sector, if a company purchased a building, they would not expense that building in year one. They probably capitalize it over some predetermined period, maybe 30 or 40 years. Well, it's the same principle for capitalization of software. We buy a software and we put it on our balance sheet and then we'll expense it over a number of periods. For Sunny Mae, the purchase and build out of Sunny Mae Express, and for HFA, the BAM project, are examples of the software that we're going to be capitalizing. Okay, I'm on slide 13 now. GAAP states that we should capitalize intangibles, and management should determine the cost threshold for capitalization. So what that means is that we have to determine at what point do we start capitalizing as opposed to expensing the cost. And we determined that about $500,000 is a reasonable point to capitalize any kind of software or internally developed software. We will capitalize the software over its useful life. For book purposes, we have determined that life to be about 10 years. Our expectation, however, is that the software will actually be utilized for a longer period of time. However, with technology evolving at such an accelerated rate, we feel 10 years is a conservative benchmark for useful life. For internally developed software, there are generally three activity stages, as noted on the on page 13. There's the preliminary project stage, the application development stage, and the post-implementation stage. The only cost that GAAP allows us to capitalize are those in the application development stage, which really involves just building the software, configurations, testing, installation of hardware, et cetera. So if you turn to slide 14, this is from the Sunny Mae statement of net position. I've circled the capitalized assets, and like I mentioned earlier, this is really the Sunny Mae Express. So why do we have this policy? It's GAAP, and a major focus of GAAP is comparability among financial statements of similar entities. So it's sort of an apples-to-apples view. If you look at another entity and you see capitalized software, you know that it's being treated the same way that we do on our entities. So on slide 14, $1 million as of 10/31/17 is a relatively small dollar amount. However, it's important to understand because the costs that are going to be associated with BAM are going to be more material. Any questions on capitalization so far? Okay, slide 15. The next accounting policy that I say I come back to by way of an example relates to deferred outflows and inflows of resources. Again, this policy is derived from GAAP. Return to slide 16. This shows the Tobacco Settlement Finance Corporation condensed statement of net position. And back in 2003, TFFC issued about $4.2 billion in Series A and Series B bonds. These proceeds were securitized in exchange for future TSRs, tobacco settlement revenues, which are used to pay debt service on the outstanding bonds. The balance of the deferred outflows of resources is amortized or written off over time in proportion to the bonds outstanding, such that when all bonds are redeemed, the deferred outflow of resource balance would have been written down to zero. On the bottom, you see the deferred inflow of resources. This represents the deferred gain attributable to fiscal 2011 and 2014 refundings. The difference between the reacquisition price and the net carrying amount of the old debt will be deferred as a component of interest expense in a systematic and rational manner over the remaining life of the refunded bonds or the life of the refunding bond, whichever is shorter. Other transactions that may be captured as deferred outflows and inflows of resources include pension gains and losses, change in fair value of hedging swaps, and deferred gains and losses on bond refundings. Those are reflected in Sunny Mae and HFA's financial statements. So we report this way because, again, it's GAAP, and GAAP requires us to assure that like transactions are reported the same way by all government entities. Page 17 and 18 are just examples of other government entities. I think I have one from the California Housing Finance Fund, and on page 18, the Texas Department of Housing and Community Affairs. And I circled the deferred items, and you can be assured that those items will be accounted for the same way that we do here at Sunny Bay. Are there any questions on deferred outflows and inflows of resources? Okay, so this will bring me to my final accounting policy topic for today's meeting on slide 19. And this is on the internal controls, which are sort of the backbone of our financial reporting. They're designed to prevent fraud and errors and may comprise errors that may compromise the accuracy of a company's financial statements. So we could spend easily a day on internal controls, but I'm just going to kind of go over the major tenets of our internal control functional policies for accounting. Number one, segregation of duties. Separate duties among different employees reduces the opportunity for any one person to commit fraud. And for Sunny Mae and HFA, the same person cannot set up, for example, and approve payees. That would not be a good segregation. Number two, access. Physical controls ensure that only approved employees may access company assets. So computer passwords and user restrictions are used to limit access to selected personnel. Number three, authorizations. There are specific procedures should be required for financial transactions, and there should be a list of people with authority to approve each type of transactions. So for us, all money movement requires at least two signatures and two separate bank authorizations. Number four, for record-keeping purposes, all financial statements should be backed up by general ledger reports or additional schedules. So we require a reconciliation for all accounts and balances. And finally, five, verification. The supervisor should periodically review all key general ledger accounts for accuracy, and we require that review, and a supervisor is also required to sign off on all financial statement closings. So internal control is an ongoing process that must be continually reviewed, monitored, and updated as our business model evolves and changes. We will continue to evaluate accounting policy and internal controls and apprise the board of any changes relating to these critical activities. Do you have any questions? If there are any topics, or if you want to go into more detail at a later date, just let us know. We can certainly provide that information. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
bottom of page four.
There is no unfinished business. I ask for motions and seconds to adjourn each of the five agencies, members, and directors' committee meetings.
Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the meetings adjourned. The next audit committee meetings are scheduled for Thursday, June 15th, 2017.
We need a break.
Do we have a stretch from, governance?
Keep going.
Okay, good morning. I'm going to turn things over to Linda, who will take the requisite legal steps to open up the governance committee.
I note that Todd Sherman, representing Mr. Majoika, Director of the Division of Budget, is participating in the meeting via video conference from the New York State Division of Budget Conference Center in the Capitol Building, 131 in Albany. I will ask for motions and seconds to call to order the April 13, 2017 Governance Committee meetings of the New York State Housing Finance Agency, the New York State Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Mortgage Bank, Municipal Bond Bank Agency, the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation. May I have motions for HFA and AHC?
Second.
Motion for Sunny May?
So moved.
Thank you. And motions for MBBA and TSFC?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Thank you. Please note that Mr. Weiss is Governance Committee Chair for HFA and AHC. Chairman Thompson will chair the committee meetings for MBBA and TSFC. And Chairman Visnapkis is chairperson for Sunny May and will chair the committee meeting for Sunny May. As items are presented to each committee for today's meetings, these motions and seconds, as you know, will be used unless a specific item is called for a different vote, unless any committee member wishes to record his or her vote differently. For purposes of convenience and to make sure that the meetings of the respective agencies go smoothly, items shared by one or more of the agency rules will be presented by the HFA AHC Acting Committee Chairman, Mr. Weiss.
Okay, shared items. Item one, the following minutes for the various committee meetings held on January 26, 2017 shall be deemed approved absent corrections from members and directors. The 50th HFA Governance Committee Members Meeting, the 47th AHC Governance Committee Members Meeting, the 50th Sony May Governance Committee Directors Meeting, the 45th MBBA Governance Committee Directors Meeting, the 43rd TSFC Governance Committee Members Meeting. I'm going to abstain since I missed the HFA AHC meeting.
I also abstain. I was not a member at the time of these meetings.
All right.
Item two, resolution recommending the approval of the governance committee self-evaluations. This is for all five agencies. Alex.
Thank you. So just like the audit committee did earlier, there's a requirement of the public authorities law that every year, every committee and the board evaluate how they did. So what we typically do is we send a form to all the governance committee members. This year, you know, we lost a couple, added a new person, so we didn't include them in the distribution. But we received the responses, and we use the questions that are suggested by the authority's budget office. We attach to the materials the responses, and as you can see, there's a smaller sample size than we do at the board level. But there was general unanimity on the part of most governance committee members that the committee was performing appropriately in the various categories. There were a couple of things that elicited, you know, less than complete agreement, basically. And one of them is a desire, apparently, by the governance committee members to get some additional instruction on the various legal provisions of the public authorities law as they relate to the responsibilities of governance committee members or board members. We've done that over the years since they came in 2005, but we haven't done one since in probably about 2 or 3 years, and I'll be happy to do that in a future governance committee meeting. We'll send the materials out ahead, and we'll do it just like Gary and Daryl did, but only more exciting. It's not accounting. The other point is the action plan, and we adopt an action plan every year. We're required to do that, And one of the things that I generally say when I present the action plan, because I run out of things to put in there, frankly, is I welcome any suggestions from governance committee members or board members about an additional item. What's happened to the, one of the things that's happened to the governance committee since its inception is that we now handle the contracts that used to be handled at the board meeting, and the desire was to free the board meeting for our transactions and our deals and move that to a committee level. That has skewed the work of the committee towards approving contracts, which is probably not what was originally intended. So anything else that folks want to include, let us know. And you can do that in between meetings, you know, just email us, Linda or myself. So that's it.
Alex, one suggestion. It looks like the item 8 was not addressed in the comments. I mean, really, there were two items that were picked up, items 5
right.
And right. item 11. But item 8, that the committee members, directors have the option of influencing the meeting agenda. It might, just as a suggestion, maybe circulate the agenda in advance and see if
okay.
there's topics that you want to add.
Good idea. Absolutely. Again, we do not want to control the agenda. So it's just yeah. a factor of a bureaucratic
yeah, understood.
Policy. So we'll do that. We'll send the agenda out ahead.
Okay. Okay.
So next, now before all five committees is a resolution of the governance committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency, the State of New York Housing Finance Agency, the State of New York Affordable Housing Corporation, the State of New York Municipal Bond Bank Agency, and the Tobacco Settlement Financing Corporation concerning self-evaluations. Assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the resolution adopted.
Item 3, resolution recommending the review and approval of HFA mission statement, and this is for HFA.
HFA only, right. So speaking of the governance committee doing what it's supposed to be doing with respect to HFA, this is a classic example of what we do. So we adopted in, back in 05, we were required by the public authorities law to adopt a mission statement. This is different than the mission statement. Like if you look in the HCR website, you see a general mission statement, paragraph, vision statement. That's all sort of PR or different. And the legal mission statement is required to be approved by the board. We started doing that in 05. We reviewed it in January. We followed with our Paris filing. We made a couple of changes in January, but Nestor and Steve had been for over a year really looking at the mission statement to try to make some more substantive changes, suggest some more substantive changes. And we kind of waited on that until the housing plan got adopted and we really knew what the various categories for housing for at least the following year are. They now are in place. And so we've circulated a draft marked up with suggested changes primarily really from Ruth Ann, our new president, and Nestor and Steve, but obviously this is going to be taken to the HFA board, so all board members have an opportunity to discuss. It's radically different than we had before. Originally, when this was put together, the goal was to keep it general, to sort of give staff latitude in terms of what to do. I think now there's a feeling to be more specific, and in terms of measurements, there's a desire to have some more categories measured. So. We're not intending, this is not required to be approved today. The goal is to circulate it. Folks should look at it. And if additional suggestions are made, we can incorporate them and bring them to the next meeting for approval. If folks want to approve it today, they can. So I'll open it up for discussion. We summarized in the memo what the main categories are of changes. Do you want me to do that or?
Yeah.
Okay. You do? Okay. So the main thing that we did was, number one, you'll see that we now have, instead of just saying providing housing in general, rental housing, we now have specific categories. Ruth Ann can address these, economic development, Mitchell Lama, supportive housing, et cetera. And then the main other change is, how do we measure how we did? And so there were really four categories. One, effectiveness of the use of cap. This is one of the changes that HFA started about 2-3 years ago. I think it's Steve's initial urging. How do we save on cap? We changed the way we use cap, so I guess the idea now is let's measure how we're doing. green initiatives. Last year, green initiatives came into play in a lot of our affordable deals. So now let's test. We're, I think, the only housing agency doing green bonds certified. So let's test how we're doing going forward. A third, which had not been addressed at all originally, when this started, you know, we weren't really linked with DHCR, so a lot of the fair housing stuff was not viewed as applying to HFA. Now clearly it does, so we've added a new category so that we will now be reviewing marketing plans to ensure compliance with fair housing. And the third one is, I think, creative financing mechanisms. Over the years, we've changed the way we do things. You know, the private placements, the now the placing mortgages with FFB rather than issuing bonds. I'm forgetting a third, but there were really three main HFA new financing vehicles that were not in place 5 years ago. So the idea is, let's test how those vehicles are doing. Are they serving our goals or the market's goals? Are there other mechanisms that we could be implementing? So that's the third main addition. And then the final one was to make it clear that the role of the board in terms of providing policy guidance and strategic direction rather than simply just approving a transaction.
Yeah, I think, Alex, this is, you've done great work here, and I think we're moving in the right direction. I think there's probably some additional comments, so maybe it makes sense to defer a vote on this until, I mean, unless there's some urgency.
No, nope, there is no urgency.
So great. Why don't we kind of defer a vote on this, and then we can revisit it at the next committee meeting.
Okay. And I just want to thank Ruthann and her team for, they really, the bulk of the work here in the mission statement categories comes from that team. And it's, again, much more detailed than we've ever had and gives a lot more guidance to the board.
And I think the point to be made here is that this is it's an evolution. So the, you know, what we agreed to hopefully at the next meeting doesn't necessarily mean it has to be static. It's something that should evolve over time and reflective of what the market is and the conditions.
And that's the idea behind the law. You're supposed to review it every year, not just to continue it, but to see whether it's still working.
So what do we do? Do we just
defer? Go on to item four.
Okay, item four. Annual review, the next four items in the agenda are consent items. There'll be no discussion on the following items unless board members and directors so desire. Item four, annual review and approval of facility-related purchase orders and contracts, including review of agency insurance policies, and this is for HFA, AHC, and Sony May.
Now before HFA and Sony May committees, is a resolution of the HIF governance committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency and the State of New York Finance Agency authorizing contractual agreements for facilities, telecommunications, and administration services. Assuming the first and second previously entered for HFA and Sunny May committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motions are carried and the resolution is adopted.
Resolution approving and reviewing information technology IT services contractual agreements, and this is for HFA and Sony May. Linda.
So now before the HFA and Sony May committees is a resolution of the governance committees of the State of New York Mortgage Agency and the State of New York Housing Finance Agency reviewing and approving the continued retention of information technology contracts with Application Oriented Designs Incorporated in Tears Point, New York, LLC, and approving expenditures under the purchase order contracts with Dell Marketing, LLC. Assuming the first and second previously entered for Sunny May and HFA committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 The motions are carried and the resolution adopted.
Item six, authorization to extend Sunny May's contract with New York Press for ad placement services and to enter into ad consultant contracts with Dixon Schwabel Advertising, Inc. and Butler Till annual review of marketing-related contracts for Sunny May mortgage products, and again, this is just for Sony May.
So now before the Sony May committee is a resolution of the governance committee of the State of New York Mortgage Agency approving the contracts for advertising placement and services and advertising consultant services. Assuming the first and second previously entered for Sony May committee, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion is carried and the resolution adopted.
Item seven, approval of purchase order contracts with the New York Times and annual review online legal research providers for HFA.
Now before HFA, the HFA Governance Committee is a resolution of the Governance Committee of the State of New York Housing Finance Agency approving purchase order contracts, expenditures for legal notices with the New York Times. Assuming the first and second previously entered for the HFA's Governance Committee, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motion is carried and the resolution adopted.
The next item on the agenda is an information item. There will be no discussion on this item unless committee directors or members so desire. Item 8, annual review of agency leases for New York City and Buffalo offices, and this is for HFA and Sunny May. Okay. There being no business, I'll ask for a motion and a second to adjourn each of the five agency members and directors committee meetings. Linda.
So assuming the first and second previously entered for all five committees, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The motions are carried and the meetings adjourned. The next governance committee meetings are scheduled for Thursday, June 15th, 2017.